are holy, sacred, and count as places of pilgrimage all spots which display a special beauty of splendor of nature. The Himalayas of India are sacred, and the Vindhya hills, our majestic rivers are sacred, Lake Manasa and the confluence of the Ganges and the Yamuna are sacred. India has saturated with her voice and worship the great nature with which her children are surrounded, whose light fills their eyes with gladness, and whose water cleanses them, whose food gives them life, and from whose majestic mystery come forth constant declaration of the infinite in music, scent, and color, bringing awakening to their souls. India gains the world through worship, through communion of souls. The idea of freedom to which India aspired was based upon realization of spiritual unity. It is India's duty to be loyal to this great truth and never allow it to be extinguished by the storm of passion sweeping over the present-day world. That is why we must be careful today to try to find out the principles by means of which India will be able for certain to realize herself. That principle is neither commercialism nor nationalism. It is not merely self-determination, but self-conquest and self-dedication. The voice of this truth was heard in India's forests of old, above the din of race conflict. It was declared in the Upanishads and expounded in the Gita. Lord Buddha renounced the world that he might make this truth the household word for all mankind. Kabir, Nanak, and other great spirits of India continued to proclaim its message. India's grand achievement, which is still stored deep within her heart, is waiting to unite within itself Hindu, Muslim, Buddhist, and Christian, not by force, not by the apathy of resignation, but in the harmony of active cooperation. Ananda Devakam.